you can see 3D. And basically, we've been putting our heads together and we've kind of thinking about, you know, open source and what it means to the community, what we've gained from this, everything that's happened here. I mean, we're here at Berg, this is exactly what this event is all about. So, a little bit of history about Aleph Objects, the company that we're from. We are a free software, Libre Innovation, open source hardware company. Every single thing that we do, we post online for free. Build materials, we put our full assembly line, assembly directions. We even have a page that will tell you exactly how to clone our products and sell them yourself. We do not mind whatsoever. We go to the point where not so much just releasing source files, we will actually have a sync to our internal development servers where we sync every 30 minutes online. So it allows you to know that if we ever do make a change, it doesn't matter what it is, we know about it. You go ahead and incorporate this and help foster the spirit of innovation within this community. We started in 2011, and it started with just two or three people, and since then we have grown to over 140 employees. So we've sold over 80 countries, and we've helped share this technology with everyone around the world. So a lot of people hear of free and open source, and a lot of people get confused saying, what does this mean? You mean you're just going to give us our stuff for free? The best way to think about this is that we are free and open as in free speech, not so much free beer, although we would all love that. And one of the reasons why we do this is because the 3D printing boom, we all know it was locked up in patent restrictions for quite some time. If these patent restrictions weren't around, over 30 years ago, this technology would have been in everybody's hands, and everybody would have been able to use it. And you just look around here today, you see multiple printers out here, multiple technological advances were made possible, just like people in this room. We get a piece of technology, we hold onto it, we think that it's great, and we're like, well, I want to change that one little thing just to make it that much better. And it's absolutely amazing. That leads to the global development community. We have basically one of the largest R&D departments on the planet, I would say, personally, just because we have so many innovations that have been granted from the public. I mean, you think about just some of the hardware that's popular. Everybody here has heard of Cura. He's able to take the cost of a printer from many, many, many thousands of dollars down to a price point that would be realistic for everybody that is here. Everybody can get their hands on it. This isn't just hardware. This is also with software. I mean, there's joint collaboration with many people out there with Slicer, Cura, Monkey Print, Octoprint, everything out there that is open and being worked on by the community individually. As a whole, in order to better improve the products. This is one of the items that is so, so important. The only way that this can happen is if you are willing to share information, technology, everything that has come together for this. One of the biggest things about that is because everything we do is open source, we like to try to get as much open source development and sort of help in the community as possible. And one of the big things about that is if you get that technology out there, you have more manufacturers, you have more people that are able to do this, produce this, help create better products in general. Whatever problem you may be running into, there is probably somebody out there that ends up having a solution to that. You're just willing to share your information, your processes, your techniques about what's going on, you can end up getting that advanced much, much quicker. And that is one of the biggest exciting things that we've been able to work with IC3D about. And, I'd like to invite you up here to have me tell you a little bit about it. That's all right.
Hi, I'm Michael Cow. Just a little bit about IC3E. It was founded in my basement in 2012. Started getting into desktops in 2011, and found myself really loving the machinery and the mechanics behind the printers. So within the first year, I really found the RepRap community, fell in love with the Cura and the Limo Max, and we ended up building about 50 or 60 of those in that year, just for fun and for people who wanted to print. And then in 2013, we started manufacturing filament. that wasn't just an overnight decision. I'll explain how we got into that, a few factors that went into that decision. And then about a little over a year ago, we started offering 3D printing service because so many people asked for us to help them make their thing. If you think about the number of people and companies who would want a printer to print things themselves, there are 10 or more times more people who need things made for them, but they don't want to invest or they fear the technology or whatever. So, and then when I started in 2012, I was actually had a day job at a big corporation, maybe like many of you. And so I just made the leap last year to become full time, finally. So I'm kind of the new guy, even though we've found about 5 years ago. But right now we have a team of about 12 people. About five people are full time, including the manufacturing and the print shop, and with some other assistants. Our mission is to democratize manufacturing, and then thereby unlocking the human potential. All that means is our background is in manufacturing. I was an automotive design engineer for 13 years and dealt with a lot of traditional high volume manufacturing. As you guys know, getting into manufacturing for the first time is a very high bar to cross nowadays. You can't just start a factory. So, with our way of helping out the mission is to, again, provide consumables and some other things so that anything can be made anywhere by any man. That's kind of our motto. So in 2012, this is a shot of my basement. Again, I was in love with this frame. This is what I did in nights and weekends. So right now, today our three areas of focus is in consumables. So we say consumables. Most of you, when you see IC3D, you see our filaments. But we're really focused on consumables. We are researching also liquid resins. We're trying to understand, where are powdered plastics, powdered foams, and things like that. Even paper, we mess with LOM. So where is all that going to play out? And then where can we, support the community? We also, not 3D printing, but we also sell our line of PCL, which actually, maybe some of you know, that's the origins of RepRap. Has PCL as a filament, very low temperature, melting filaments. Our second, again, it's service bureau. So consumables is about what you need to 3D print yourself. Service, we help answer the question, how can we help you 3D print? And then we also are doing consulting for larger manufacturers and saying, how can 3D printing integrate into your workflow, right? To save you a lot of time, lead time, and cost. And again, our background's kind of heavy industry, so that's kind of how we think, and that's where the opportunity is that we can help people. So why did we decide to make 3D printing filament? So a lot of factors happened all at once to make us go in that direction. In 2012, 2013, we tried to at first partner with the filament manufacturer. We didn't want to just buy an extrusion machine and start making filament. But the problem was, we did get a lot of material from various companies. But we found out that these folks traditionally made non-filament product. They made plastic welding rod, or they made fishing lines, food whacker lines, and the specifications just didn't match. One was diameter tolerance and things like that, that's simple. But the other one was also about contaminants. Usually they're extruding something, and that product isn't going to be re-extruded into something with a finer tip, like what we're doing. So it didn't matter. It's not like they made a bad product. It was just for a different industry. And so the second bullet point, there is always a mystery. Right? There is this mystery jam on the filament, especially early on. And it was really hard to pinpoint. And so we kind of had two eureka moments. I kind of go back to these two moments. The first moment is when we said, hey, oh wow, it takes a really long time to purge black out with white film.
Yeah,
how long does it take? And then even when you think you've parsed it all out, you go to print your white parts and it's left gray at the bottom. And you're like, okay. It's only such a small hot end, it's such a small amount of room. What the heck? The second eureka moment was when we were working with these contract extruders, we noticed that an extrusion company, a filament company, might only have 4 to 6 extrusion lines or something. But a lot of them would extrude any kind of plastic you could give them. So any formulation of ABF, any whatever, PC, anything. And then we said, okay, if it takes such a long time to purge a little hot end, you know, how long does it really take to purge out a big extrusion line, right? And so we started digging into extrusion extruders, big scale, 3-foot-long extruders. And there's a lot of components. There's a lot of nooks and crannies where plastic can hide, right? And so then we thought, if you're swapping out different polymers through a big extruder, how do you actually guarantee that if you ran Polycarb for a customer, and then you ran PLA for another customer for 3D printing filament, how do you guarantee that 100%, it's 100% pure PLA? And what if you have a little tiny speck of Polycarb that likes 50 degrees hotter? What's that going to do your printer? It might jam, right? But that's why we say mystery jam, because it's so hard to detect those kinds of contaminants in filament. All right, so we established that there was a market for this, and that this was needed. A 3D printed purpose filament was needed, and we had a number of us, including myself, had experience in injection molding, which essentially uses an extruder also, just different downstream equipment. And so we got together, got some equipment, partnered with the local factory to use their space and work out a manpower deal, and started making ABS in 2013. In 2014, we purchased a second extrusion line dedicated to just PLA. So, first line, only ABS, only one compound. Second line, only one compound of PLA. That was our way of being able to guarantee 100% that it was that formulation. So it's pretty simple. The reason why other folks wouldn't do that is because the volume for 3D printing didn't support that. It wasn't designed to dedicate that line, that would be equivalent to one compound. So this is part of our operation, our filament operation. This is in Hillsboro, Ohio. This is our, it's hard to see, but this is our line one. This is our line two. These are just Gaylords of material. Here's our re-spooling and bagging operation. Basic components, a big extruder, a water bath cooling, a dual axis laser gauge, to check axis, diameter, two axes, get the average, and also check the roundness. There's a puller, pulling the strand through the entire system, and then a winder.
It's so simple, but that would be like...
So when you start and stop a line, this filament's going to be out of spec until you get it up to speed and temperature. And so we have a lot of out-of-spec filament that we'll just build up, and then we'll send to the recycling facility once every X amount of months, whenever that builds up. It makes good bedding material also. And then so a little bit about our 3D printing shop in Columbus. So we have 4 kind of larger size printers, 12 desktops. We consume about 10% of what we manufacture ourselves. So that allows us to also do a lot of R&D, a lot of testing, as you can imagine. So out of our factory, we actually make these 20 pounders. They look like this. So we pop these out at the end of the line, and then we actually re-spool those to 2 or 1 kg and 5 pounders. So in our shop, this is a cubic meter printer, build volume, and here's a 20 pounder. And so we're just consuming those, about 1 a week. Here's a medium-sized printer. It's about 24, 24, 32. So this is the life of a 3D printer tech right here. It's his job. So we do stuff like, we sponsor a lot of people, we sponsor schools and cool projects, anyone doing anything really interesting. For example, cosplay. Cosplay is a huge industry now. There are a lot of people doing really crazy things. This guy, Yasutano, he's one of the guys at the forefront of 3D printed cosplay costumes and weapons and armor. Fallout 4, T60 armor, this is 100% 3D printed. And we found out what he was trying to do, and we ended up sending him 90 pounds of filament. And that's all PLA and some TPUs for the joints and things. He printed that and he finished that. And then we ended up hiring him. So what he does now is he's nearly full time printing props and things and stuff for people. It's part of our service group. This is another shot of him on stage, 7 foot tall. He's on like foot tall sticks inside. Weighs 90 pounds with a PVC 2 frame, and he's a triathlete too, so maybe a normal person, including myself, couldn't even swim. Okay, so what we're doing today is we're kind of publicly announcing a collaboration between IC3D and LulzBot to do the world's first open source hardware certified filament, 3D printed filament. So there's open source, right, which is just the general movement, but then there's OSHW. There's the Open Source Hardware Association that was created a couple years ago to officially kind of check things, make sure people are following certain guidelines, issuing unique codes for products, and just legitimizing the movement. So we're working on becoming the first certified. Hopefully that happens in a month. So the product doesn't change. What that means is simply we're putting out some information on how to manufacture filament on a large scale. So we're going to have more pictures, more details. We're going to have our settings, our temperatures, our pull speeds, our water bath temperatures, and things like that. So technically, someone else could get equipment and start manufacturing filament. So why is this important for the community? Right now, there are actually not that many filament manufacturers. There are a lot of brands. Many of those brands come from the same manufacturer, whether it's a U.S. company or Chinese or wherever else. And then two, again, a lot of those manufacturers started making another product. So right now, the reason why quality in general is increasing in filament, I would say, is because the 3D printing industry has increased, right? The demand for consumables has increased, making it more economical for these companies to dedicate, to improve quality and dedicate, again, that single compound to the equipment. Point number three was that if you deal with plastics, you'll know that there are thousands and thousands of compounds of various plastics, various types within, ABS, PLA, and so forth. But relative to that, there's very little funding available. So that's another goal of doing this open source certification is if this spawns a bunch of US-made, higher quality, dedicated filament producers of all kinds of materials, then that helps the entire community. And so that's our goal for that. So some of our future plans, we're hoping to do more methodical testing and then post that test data results, for free on our website, where someone at home or wherever can replicate that and have some kind of confidence, some kind of test data, even if it's surrogate test data for what they're making. So to achieve that, we're gonna do a lot of testing with standard, for example, ASTM dog bones, if you're familiar with tensile testing and all that. So print out a bunch of samples at specific profiles, that's key, for specific materials and for specific equipment. Right? So if you have, let's say, a TAS 6, and you have our ABS or whatever, and you choose that profile in Cura, you can have at least a certain confidence level that it passed, it achieved a certain tensile strength. Right? And that's why we're partnered with the Ohio State University to use their Instron because these are really expensive, like six figures. So we're excited for this. And this is an activity we're doing full time. So we're excited to continue the relationship between with LulzBot and the open source community, and we hope to continue to certify more materials. Right now we're officially certifying ABS, and this is going to do PLA, and hopefully more materials. So with that one, thank you for listening to Brent and I. Someone has the idea, of course the marketing folks had the idea of an official passing of the t-shirts. Final note, HR, maybe put this in. IC3D is hiring. People hang out in Central Ohio, a lot of microbreweries, 3D print stuff all day, tinker with 3D printers. We have no shortage of CAD work, technicians, software techies. And also, if you're doing something interesting, like something for the community, something nonprofit, connected to school, let us know. We give a lot of free coaching to that. So, thank you again. Questions? So the question is about regrind, and in injection molding companies, like most of your car interior parts and stuff around the house, most of the things at Walmart, injection molding, they most factories are allowed to use, for example, 20% of regrind. All that means is when you inject something, you have screws, you have excess, you have out of spec parts, you're able to regrind that and throw that back into the hopper. Up to, let's say, 20%. We use 100% virgin. There's two reasons, three reasons. One is that when you re-heat cycle something, you usually degrade it. It's not always more brittle, but it changes the chemical properties. And because we can't really guarantee that, we just send all the stuff to the cycle. But two, it actually gives it a dull effect when you put the grind through. I think that has something to do with the mechanics also, but that kind of thing. And three, it's when you process regrind and put it back in, there's just more opportunity for debris and contamination. And so we just don't deal with it. And yeah, we do have to, so therefore the cost will increase a little bit. It's more of a quality of time. Thanks again.